Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the online classes of Basic Electrical Engineering. We are going to discuss a few numerical examples. And after making discussion on the numerical examples, we shall explain the standard loop equations. If you guys remember, we derived the equation for the voltage across the capacitor during the charging process and the voltage across the capacitor during discharging process. So these numerical examples are related to the charging and discharging of a capacitor. So we do example number one. In example number one, this is the solved numerical example from my personal book, which is example number 9 of chapter number 1. So in this numerical example, we have a capacitor which has a capacitance of 20 microfarad. And this capacitor is charged to a potential difference of 400 volt. So this capacitor is charged with the help of a DC voltage source, and the voltage of the DC voltage source is 400 volts. And then it is discharged through a resistor of 100 kilo ohm. So the value of the series resistor is 100 kilo ohm. So we discharge this capacitor through the series resistor. The resistance of the resistor is 100 kilo ohm. We need to find out the time constant, initial value of discharging, current and voltage across the capacitor after 2 seconds. We know that the time constant of this RC series circuit will be equal to RC. We know the resistance of this series circuit. The resistance of this series circuit is 100 kilo ohm. And the capacitance of this series circuit is 20 microfarad. So the product of these two quantities give you 2 seconds. So the time constant of this series circuit is 2 seconds. We know that the discharging current is calculated with the help of this particular equation. I is equal to Vs by R into e raised to power minus t by RC. And we want to find out the initial value of the discharging current. And we know that the initial value of the discharging current takes place at time t is equal to 0. So if we put the value of t in the above equation, e raised to power minus 0 results in 1. So the initial value of the discharging current will be equal to Vs by R. Vs is 400 volt and R is 100 kilo ohm. So the initial value of the discharging current is 4 milliampere. Now we want to find out the voltage across the capacitor after 2 seconds. So we derived this equation for the voltage across the capacitor. The voltage across the capacitor is equal to Vs e raised to power minus t by RC. We want to find out the voltage at time t is equal to 2 seconds. So time t is 2 seconds and RC is 2 seconds as well. If we put the value of t and RC, in this particular equation we get e raised to power minus 1. So putting the value of t and RC in this particular equation, we get another equation for the voltage across the capacitor. The voltage across the capacitor will be equal to Vs into e raised to power minus 1. And we put the value of 400 volts. So the voltage will be volt. Voltage across volt. Time constant we consider, which is 0, and we circuit is 4 seconds. Find out the initial value of the charging current. In order to find out the initial value of the charging current, we consider the equation for the charging current. We can find out the charging current with the help of this equation. That is, I is equal to Vs by R into e raised to power minus t by RC. And we know that the initial value of the current takes place at time t is equal to 0. So if we put the value of t in this particular equation, e raised to power minus 0 is equal to 1. So the initial value of the charging current can be calculated with the help of this particular equation. The initial value of the current will be equal to Vs by R, and we know that the initial value of the charging current is a maximum current. This current will be the maximum current in the circuit. With the passage of time, this current will decrease exponentially. So we put the values in this particular equation. So the voltage across the source is 200 volt. The resistance of the series circuit is 0.5 into 10 raised to power 6. So the initial value of the charging current is 400 microampere. Now we are going to find out the current in this circuit after this much time, that is at time t is equal to 4 seconds. So t is 4, we want to find out the value of the charging current at time t is equal to 4 seconds. And we know that the time constant of this series circuit is 4 seconds as well. So if we put the values in this particular equation, we get this particular equation. That is, the charging current in the capacitor will be equal to Vs by R into e raised to power minus 1. And we put the values in this particular equation. You see Vs is 200 volt. The resistance is 0.5 into 10 raised to power 6 ohm. And we simplify e raised to power minus 1 as well. So the current in the capacitor after 2 seconds turns out to be 147.15 microampere. So the initial value of the current was 400 microampere, and the current in the capacitor after 4 seconds is 147.15 microampere. We know that we can find out the voltage across the capacitor with the help of this equation. Vc is equal to Vs into 1 minus e raised to power minus t by Rc. And we want to find out the voltage across the capacitor at time t is equal to 4 seconds. So we put the value of t and the value of Rc in this particular equation, and we know that Rc in this particular equation will be 4. So if we put the value of t and Rc in this particular equation, we get this equation, that is Vc is equal to Vs into 1 minus e raised to power minus 1, and we know that Vs is 200 volts. So 200 into 1 minus e raised to power minus 1 gives you 126.4 volt. So the voltage across the capacitor after 4 seconds will be 126.4 volts. Now we know the equation for the voltage across the capacitor. The voltage across the capacitor is equal to Vs into 1 minus e raised to power minus t by Rc. And we want to find out the time taken by the capacitor so that the voltage across the capacitor is 160 volt. So we are going to find out the time in this particular equation now. Why? Because the voltage across the capacitor is known, that is 160 volt. How much time this capacitor will take so that it is charged to a voltage of 160 volt. So we put the values in this particular equation. The voltage across the capacitor is 160. The voltage across the source is 200 volt. Rc of the circuit is 4. So we have 1 minus e raised to power minus t by 4. So we put the values in this equation. And we simplify this equation. So we obtain e raised to power minus t by 4, which is equal to 0.2. And minus t by 4 will be equal to log of 0.2. So minus t by 4 will be equal to log of 0.2. So the time comes out to be 6.44 second. So after 6.44 second, the voltage across the capacitor will be 160 volt. So these two numerical examples are there in my personal book. You guys can study these numerical examples. We are going to start chapter number 2, and the first topic of chapter number 2 is the loop analysis or the mesh analysis, and we are going to derive the standard loop equations in this particular topic. So we are going to start chapter number 2, and in chapter number 2 we are going to study mesh analysis, and we will derive the standard loop equation with the help of loop analysis or mesh analysis. So what we do, we consider a circuit having two loops. You see, there are two loops in this particular circuit. Here is loop number one and here is loop number two. The current in loop number one is in the clockwise direction, that is I1, and the current in loop number two is in the clockwise direction as well, and this current is I2. So there are two loops in this particular circuit. The current in loop number one is I1 and the current in loop number two is I2. I1 and I2 are in the clockwise direction. You see, the current in R1 is I1. The current in R3 is I2. And there are two currents in this resistor. The current I1 in this resistor is in the downward direction, and the current I2 is in the upward direction. So the net current through this resistor R2 will either be I1 minus I2 or I2 minus I1. It depends upon the numerical values of I1 and I2. If I1 is greater than I2, then the current in this resistor R2 will be I1 minus I2. And if I2 is greater than I1, then the current through this resistor will be I2 minus I1. At the moment, we don't know the numerical values of I1 and I2. So we will assume that the current through this resistor R2 is I1 minus I2 while making calculation for loop number one. So when we make calculation for loop number one, then we shall assume that the current through this common resistor is I1 minus I2. And when we make calculation for loop number two, we shall assume that the current through this common resistor is I2 minus I1. So this should be pretty clear to you guys. The current in this resistor is I1. The current through this resistor is I2. When we make calculation for loop number one, the current through this common resistor will be I1 minus I2. And when we make calculation for loop number two, the current through this common resistor will be I2 minus I1. So what we do, we consider loop number one and we apply KVL to loop number one. According to KVL, the sum of the voltage rises in loop number one is equal to the sum of the voltage drops. Keeping in view the direction of this loop current, the voltage across this source is a voltage rise. So the voltage across this source is a voltage rise. The voltage across this resistor will be a voltage drop, and the voltage across this resistor will be a voltage drop. So we apply KVL to loop number one. So according to KVL, the voltage across the source is a voltage rise. The voltage across the resistor R1 is I1R1, and this is a voltage drop. And the voltage across R2 is I1 minus I2 into R2, and this is a voltage drop as well. So we apply KVL to loop number 1 and we obtain equation number 2.1 with the help of KVL. So E1 will be equal to I1 R1 plus I1 minus I2 R2. We rearrange equation number 2.1. So we have R1 plus R2 into I1 plus minus R2 into I2, which is equal to E1, and this is equation number 2.2. So what we do, we rearrange equation number 2.1 and we obtain equation number 2.2. Let us focus on R1 plus R2. Let us consider R1 and R2 in the diagram. So you see, R1 belongs to loop number 1 and R2 belongs to loop number 1 as well. So R1 plus R2 gives you the sum of all the resistances of loop number 1, and the sum of all the resistances of loop number 1 is represented by R11, which is known as the total self resistance of loop number 1. So you see, we consider equation number 2.2 and we focus on R1, on R1 plus R2, and R1 plus R2 is sum of all the resistances of loop number 1, and this sum is represented by R11, which is known as the total self resistance of loop number 1. So we replace R1 plus R2 by R11 in equation number 2.2. Right? Now we focus on R2. We ignore this minus sign for the time being. We will talk about this minus sign later on. Let us consider R2. So let us consider this resistor in the circuit diagram. R2 belongs to loop number 1 as well as loop number 2. So this is a common resistor. R2 is a common resistor. This resistor belongs to loop number 1 as well as loop number 2. So as we are making calculation for loop number 1, so this is why we represent the resistance of this common resistor by R12. One is coming first because we are making calculation for loop number 1 at the moment. So this common resistor is represented by R12. We will talk about this minus sign later on. So R2 in equation number 2.2 is a resistor, is the resistance of a, of the resistor which belongs to loop number 2 as well as loop number 1. So if we ignore minus sign with the resistance R2 in equation number 2.2, then this is the resistance of the resistor that belongs to loop number 1 as well as loop number 2. This common resistor R2 is represented by R12. There is minus R2 is represented by R12. So let us consider equation number 2.2. So we consider equation number 2.2 and we replace R1 plus R2 by R11 and we replace minus R2 by R12. So what do we get? We get R11 I1 plus R12 I2, which is equal to E1, right? So we put these values in equation number 2.2. If we put these values in equation number 2.2, we obtained equation number 2.5, right? You see, R11 I1 plus R12 I2 is equal to E1. Now we apply KVL to loop number 2. So let us consider the second loop of the circuit diagram and let us apply KVL to loop number 2. So we consider the circuit diagram and we apply KVL to loop number 2. The current I2 is in the clockwise direction. So you see, this current I2 flows from the positive terminal of the voltage source towards the negative terminal. So the voltage across the source is a voltage drop. So the voltage across the source is a voltage drop. The voltage across the resistor R3 will be a voltage drop, and the voltage across the resistor R2 will be a voltage drop. And KVL says that the sum of the voltage rises in loop number 2 will be equal to sum of the voltage drops. So let us apply KVL to loop number 2. If we apply KVL to loop number 2, we obtain equation number 2.6. So we apply KVL to loop number 2 and we obtain equation number 2.6. You see, the voltage across the source is a voltage drop. That's why we place a minus sign with this voltage on this side. The voltage across R3 is I2R3, which is a voltage drop, and the voltage across R2 is I2 minus I1 into R2, which is the voltage drop as well. So what we do, we rearrange equation number 2.6. So let us rearrange equation number 2.6. If we rearrange equation number 2.6, we get R2 plus R3 into I2 minus R2 into I1, which is equal to minus E2. We get, you see, minus sign with this voltage because the voltage of this voltage source was a voltage drop. And what we do, we focus on R2 plus R3. So let us focus on R2 plus R3 and let us consider R2 plus R3 in the circuit diagram. So we go back to the circuit diagram. Here is the circuit diagram. We consider loop number 2 and there are two resistors in this particular loop, R3 and R2. So R2 plus R3 is the sum of all the resistances of loop number 2, this sum is represented by R22, and this sum is known as the total self-resistance of loop number 2. So R2 plus R3 represents the sum of all the resistance of loop number 2, which is represented by R22. So we replace R2 plus R3 in equation number 2.7 by R22. You see, R2 plus R3 is sum of all the resistance of loop number 2, and this sum is represented by R22, that is known as the total self-resistance of loop number 2. So R2 plus R3 is equal to R22. We ignore the minus sign with the R2 for the time being. We will talk about, you see, this minus sign later on. So we ignore the minus sign with this R2, and let us consider R2 in the circuit diagram. Here is the circuit diagram, and here is R2. You see, R2 belongs to loop number 2 as well as loop number 1. At the moment, we are making calculation for loop number 2. So the resistance of this common resistor is represented by R21. 2 is coming first because we are in loop number 2 at the moment. So we ignore this minus sign at the moment. We will explain it later on. So we replace this minus R2 by R21. Right? So we go back to equation number 2.7. In equation number 2.7, this R2 plus R3 is replaced by R22, and this minus R2 is replaced by R21. So you see, we replace R2 plus R3 by R22. What is R22? This is the total self-resistance of loop number 2. Basically, we take the sum of all the resistance of loop number 2. And minus R2 is the resistance of the resistor which belongs to loop number 2 as well as loop number 1. So we replace minus R2 by R21. So if we put these values in equation number 2.7, we obtain equation number 2.10. So R21 into I1 plus R22 into I2 will be equal to minus E2. So this is equation number 2.10. This is equation number 10 of chapter number 2. Right? So what we do, let me consider equation number 2.5. So we consider 2.5, that is R11 into I1 plus R12 into I2, which is equal to E1. And we consider equation number 10, which is R21 into I1 plus R22 into I2, which is equal to minus E2. We consider these two equations once again. Right? So we ignore the minus sign with E2 for the time being. We will talk about, you see, this minus and plus sign later on. And we write equation number 2.5 and equation number 2.10 once again. So we have R11 plus I1 प्लस आर वन टू, आर वन वन आई वन प्लस आर वन टू आई टू विच इज इक्वल टू ई वन, आर टू वन आई वन प्लस आर टू टू आई टू विच इज इक्वल टू ई टू. सो वी अपटेन दीज टू इक्वेशंस. दीज टू इक्वेशंस आर रिप्रेजेंटेड बाय ए एंड बी, एंड दीज टू इक्वेशन आर नोन एज द स्टैंडर्ड लूप इक्वेशन फॉर अ सर्किट हैविंग टू लूप्स. यू सी, इफ वी कंसीडर द ओरिजिनल सर्किट ऑफ दिस टॉपिक, यू सी देयर आर टू लूप्स इन दिस पर्टिकुलर इक्वेशन एंड वी गेट टू स्टैंडर्ड लूप इक्वेशंस फॉर दिस पर्टिकुलर सर्किट. So equation A and B are known as the standard loop equations for a circuit having two loops. So basically the number of standard loop equations depends upon the number of loops. If there are two loops in a circuit, there will be two standard loop equations. If there are three loops in a circuit, there will be three standard loop equations. If there are n loops in a circuit, there will be n standard loop equations. So what we do now, we consider a circuit having three loops. So let us consider a circuit having three loops. So we are going to write down the standard loop equation for a circuit having three loops. So here is the first equation, R11I1 plus R12I2 plus R13I3 is equal to E1. This will be equation number one. Here is the second equation, R21I1 plus R22I2 plus R23I3 is equal to E2. This is the second equation. And here is third equation, R31I1 plus R32I2 plus R33I3, which is equal to E3. This is equation number three. So if there are three loops in a circuit, there will be three standard loop equations, and these are the standard loop equations for a circuit with three loops. Now what we do, we consider a circuit with n loops. So we are going to write down the standard loop equation for a circuit having n loops. So here is the first equation, R11I1 plus R12I2 plus R13I3 plus and so on. The last term will be plus R1NIN, which is equal to E1. Here is equation number 2, R21I1 plus R22I2 plus R23I3 plus and so on. The last term on the left hand side of this equation will be R2NIN, which is equal to E2. Here is equation number 3, and equation number 3 is R31I1 plus R32I2 plus R33I3 plus and so on. The last term on the left hand side of equation number 3 will be R3NIN, which is equal to E3. And the last equation is equation number N, which is RN1I1 plus RN2I2 plus RN3I3 plus RNN I n, which is equal to E n. So if there are n loops in a circuit, there will be n standard loop equations. So the number of standard loop equations of a circuit depends upon the number of loops in the circuit. If there are two loops in the circuit, there will be two equations. If there are three loops in a circuit, there will be three equations. If there are four loops in a circuit, there will be four equations. Now what we do, we consider equation number A and B once again. Let us consider equation number A and B. You see, here are equation number A and B. These are the standard loop equations for our circuit, and there are two loops in our circuit. So we are going to write down these standard loop equations in matrices format. You see, we have R11I1 plus R12I2, which is equal to E1. This is equation number 1. And then we have equation number 2, which is R21I1 plus R22I2, which is equal to E2, and we are going to write down these two equations in the matrices for MET. So let us write down these two equations in the matrices for MET. So we consider equation A and B, and we are going to write down these equations in the matrices format. So in the matrices format, we have R11, R12, R21, R22, and then we have I1 and I2, and then we have E1 and E2. You see, these are the standard loop equations for our circuit, which has two loops. You see, here is the resistance matrix, here is the current matrix, and here is the voltage matrix. And what we do, we consider the size of this R matrix, the order of this R matrix. So the size R, the order of this R matrix is 2 by 2. There are three loops in the original circuit. So the size of the R matrix depends upon the number of loops in the circuit. If there are two loops in the circuit, the size of the R matrix is 2 by 2. If there are three loops in a circuit, the size of the R matrix is 3 by 3. If there are four loops in a circuit, the size of the R matrix is 4 by 4, and so on. So the size of the R matrix is 2 by 2, and the size of this R matrix depends upon the number of loops in the circuit. As there are two loops in our circuit, this is why the size of this R matrix is 2 by 2. Now we consider these elements. I mean, we consider R11 and R22. R11 and R22 lie on the diagonal of this matrix. So we call them diagonal elements. So the diagonal elements of the R matrix will be positive. There will be a plus sign with R11, a plus sign with R22, a plus sign with R33, a plus sign with R44, and so on. Right? So the diagonal elements of the R matrix are always positive, and these are the diagonal elements. So the diagonal elements of the R matrix are always positive. Now we discuss the off diagonal elements. These are the off diagonal elements. So let us talk about the off diagonal elements. There is R12 and R21, and we know that R12 is always equal to R21, and if you guys remember, this was equal to minus R2 in our case. So we consider the off diagonal elements. So the off diagonal elements will either be negative, as we have minus R2 in this particular case, or it will be positive. So there will either be a plus sign with the off diagonal elements of the R matrix or minus sign, and it depends upon the direction of the loop currents. So let us go to the circuit diagram, let us consider the loop currents, and let us talk about the plus and minus sign with the off diagonal elements. So we consider the circuit diagram of this particular topic. So you see, here is the common resistor. Here is the common resistor R2. This common resistor R2 is represented by R12, which is equal to R21, and in this particular case it is equal to minus R2. You see, there is a minus sign with the resistance of this common resistor, there may be a positive sign. We are going to discuss it. If we look at the direction of the loop currents through this common resistor, you see the current I1 is in the downward direction, the current I2 is in the upward direction. So the two loop currents in this common resistor are in the opposite direction. So if the loop currents in the common resistor are in the opposite direction, there will be a minus sign with the resistance of this common resistor. Otherwise, there will be a plus sign with the resistance of the common resistor, right? So there will be a plus sign with this resistance if these two currents are in the same direction in this resistor. If these two loop currents are in the same direction through this resistor, then there will be a plus sign with R2. Otherwise, there will be a minus sign with R2. So we have talked about, you see, the plus and minus sign with the off diagonal elements. So all the diagonal elements of the R matrix will be positive. All the off diagonal elements of R matrix will either be positive or negative. The plus and minus sign with the resistance of this common resistor depends upon the direction of the loop currents. If the loop currents are in the same direction through this common resistor, then there will be a plus sign with the resistance of this common resistor. And if the loop currents are in the opposite direction through this common resistor, then there will be a minus sign with this resistor. There was a minus sign with the resistance of this resistor because the current I1 and I2 in our case were in opposite direction through this common resistor. Now we discuss the voltage matrix. Okay, so let us talk about, you see, the voltage matrix. Here is the voltage matrix. You see, E1 was positive and E2 was negative, if you guys remember. So there will be either a plus sign with E1 or a minus sign with E1. Similarly, there will either be a plus sign with E2 or minus sign E2. You see, E1 was a voltage rise, if you guys remember. E1 was a voltage rise. Let me consider the circuit diagram once again. You see, the current I1 flows from the negative terminal of the voltage source towards the positive terminal. So this voltage is a voltage rise. If it is a voltage rise, there will be a plus sign with E1. If it is a voltage drop, there will be a minus sign with E1. Similarly, we consider E2. You see, the current I2 flows from the positive terminal of the voltage source towards the negative terminal, and this voltage is a voltage drop. As it is a voltage drop, this is why there was a minus sign with this voltage. So if E2 is a voltage drop, there will be a minus sign with E2. If E2 is a voltage rise, there will be a plus sign with this voltage. So what we do, we consider the standard loop equations in matrices format. The size of the R matrix depends upon the number of loops in the circuit. If there are two loops in the circuit, the size of the R matrix will be 2 by 2. If there are three loops in a circuit, the size of the R loop will be 3 by 3. All the diagonal elements of the resistance matrix are positive. The off diagonal elements will either be positive or negative depending upon the direction of the loop currents in this common resistor. If the loop currents are in the same direction in this common resistor, then there will be a plus sign with the resistance of the common resistor. And if the loop currents are in the opposite direction in this common resistor, then there will be a minus sign with the resistance of the common resistor. Similarly, if E1 is a voltage rise, there will be a plus sign with E1. If it is a voltage drop, there will be a minus sign with E1. If E2 is a voltage rise, there will be a plus sign with E2. And if E2 is a voltage drop, there will be a minus sign with E2. So these are the standard loop equations. And we shall find out the current I1 and I2. And we shall find out the current I1 and I2 with the help of Cramer's rules. So we calculate the current I1 and current I2 with the help of Cramer's rules. So you see, we calculate the current I1 with the help of this particular equation. For the current I1, we replace the first column of the R matrix by E1 and E2. We represent it in the form of a determinant, and we divide this determinant by the determinant of the R matrix. Similarly, for the current I2, we replace the second column of the R matrix by E1 and E2. We represent this matrix in the form of a determinant. Basically, we calculate the determinant, and we divide this determinant by the determinant of the R matrix. So we shall calculate the current I1 and I2 with the help of Cramer's rules. Once we know these two currents, we can find out the current in any circuit element of the circuit diagram. We can find out the voltage across any circuit element. We can calculate the power supplied by the voltage source or the power consumed by a resistor in this particular circuit. So let us do a few numerical example. So we consider example number 2.1, and this is the solved numerical example of my personal book. I would request you guys to purchase my book. The price of the book is 1,000, but this book will help you a lot, especially in these online classes. You guys need to have the book to understand the course. We are not in the classroom. We don't have the facilities of the marker and boards. So, I mean, it's a bit difficult for you guys to follow the online classes. Anyhow, I shall try my level best to explain the stuff befitting manner. So let us consider example number 2.1. Example number 2.1 says, consider the circuit in figure 2.2. Apply standard loop equations to find out the power consumed by the circuit and the power supplied by the two sources. So in order to calculate the power consumed by the circuit, we need to find out, we need to calculate the power consumed by R1, we need to calculate the power consumed by R2, we need to calculate the power consumed by R3, and then we need to take the sum of all these three powers, which will give you the total power consumed by the circuit. If you want to calculate the power supplied by the two voltage sources, so we will have to calculate the power supplied by E1 and the power supplied by E2. So anyhow, there are two loops in this particular circuit. E1 is 8 volt, E2 is 8 volt. R1 is 2 ohm, R3 is 2 ohm, and R2 is 1 ohm. So what we do is there are two loops in the circuit of question number 2.1. So we are going to write down the standard loop equations in matrices form for this particular circuit. And we know that the size of the R matrix will be 2 by 2. Why? Because there are two loops in this particular circuit. So let us consider the standard loop equations in matrices form. You see, the size of the R matrix is 2 by 2. Why? Because there are two loops in this particular circuit. So we consider the standard loop equations in matrices format. So we have R11, R12, R21, R22, I1, I2, and then we have E1 and E2. We will find out I1 and I2 with the help of Cramer's rules. So let us find out R11. You see, R11 is the sum of all the resistances of loop number 1. And you see, there are two resistors in loop number 1. We have a resistance of 2 ohm and a resistance of 1 ohm. So 1 plus 2 gives you 3. So R11 will be 3. You see, R11 is equal to 2 plus 1, which is 3. We know that R12 will be equal to R21, and this will give you the resistance of the resistor which belongs to loop number 1 as well as loop number 2. So let us consider the common resistor which belongs to loop number 1 as well as loop number 2. So this this resistor belongs to loop number 1 as well as loop number 2. So this resistor R2 will be represented by R12 as well as R21. We consider the direction of currents in this particular resistor. You see, the current I1 is in the downward direction in this resistor, and the current I2 is in the upward direction in this resistor. So the resistance of this resistor will be negative. There will be a minus sign with the resistance of this resistor. So you see, R12 will be equal to R21, which is equal to minus 1. So you see, R12 as well as R21 is minus 1 ohm. Then we consider R22. R22 is the total self-resistance of loop number 2. We take the sum of all the resistances of loop number 2. So let us consider all the resistances of loop number 2. You see, there are two resistors in loop number 2, R3 and R2. And the sum is 2 plus 1, the sum is 3. So R22 will be equal to 3. So the sum of all the resistances of loop number 2 is R3 plus R2, which is 2 plus 1, which is equal to 3. So R22 is 2 plus 1, which is equal to 3. So we have calculated the elements of the R matrix. Now let us consider E1. We consider the voltage source in loop number 1. Here is the voltage source in loop number 1, and you see the current flows from the negative terminal of this voltage source towards the positive terminal. So E1 will be positive, and E1 is equal to 8 volt. And then we consider the voltage source in loop number 2, and you see the current flows from the positive terminal towards the negative terminal of E2. So E2 will be negative, E2 will be minus 8, right? So E1 is plus 8, why? Because E1 is a voltage rise. E2 is minus 8, why? Because E2 is a voltage drop. So we consider the values of E1 and E2. E1 is plus 8, why? E1 is a voltage rise. E2 is minus 8, why? Because it is minus 8. So we consider these standard loop equations in MAT, and we put the values in these. Put the values of R11, R12, R21, R22, and then E1 and E2. So we put the values in this equation. If we put the values in this equation, we obtain these equations in matrices format. You see, 1 is 3, R1 2 is minus 1, R2 1 is minus 1, R2 2 is 3. We shall find out I1 and I2 with the help of Cramer's rules. E1 is 8 and E2 is minus 8. So these are the standard loop equations for this particular circuit. We are going to find out I1 and I2 with the help of Cramer's rules. So let us find out I1 and I2 with the help of Cramer's rules. For I1, we replace the first column of the R matrix by E1 and E2, so which is 8 minus 8, and we divide this determinant by the determinant of the R matrix. If we simplify it, I1 comes out to be 2 ampere. For I2, we replace the second column of the R matrix by E1 and E2, and we divide this determinant by the determinant of the R matrix. If we simplify these determinants, the current I2 comes out to be minus 2 ampere. The minus sign indicates that the direction of the current I2 is wrong. Actually, the current is in the opposite direction. So we know the current I1, which is 2 ampere. We know the current I2, which is minus 2 ampere. We go ahead. And you see, the current through the 2 ohm resistor of loop number 1 is I1, which is 2 ampere. The current through the 2 ohm resistor of loop number 2 is I2, which is minus 2 ampere. This current is in the opposite direction. The actual current will be in the opposite direction, but don't change the direction of the current in the circuit. The current in the common resistor of the circuit diagram, the common resistor of the circuit diagram is I1 minus I2, which is 2 plus 2, which is equal to 4 ampere. The power consumed by the 2 ohm resistor of loop number 1 will be equal to I1 square into R1. If we simplify it, we get 8 volt, right? Similarly, the power consumed by the 2 ohm resistor of loop number 2 will be equal to I2 square into R2, which is 2. If we simplify it, we get 8 watt. The power consumed by 1 ohm resistor of the circuit is, you see, 4 square. The current in this resistor is 4 square. The resistor is 1. So 16 multiplied by 1 is 16 watt. So we want to calculate the power consumed by the entire circuit. So the power consumed by the entire circuit will be equal to P1 plus P2 plus P3. 8 plus 8 plus 16 is 32 watt. So the power consumed by the entire circuit will be 32 watt. Now we calculate the power supplied by E1. Let us calculate the power supplied by E1. So we calculate the power supplied by E1. The voltage across E1 is 8. The current in E1 is 2 ampere. So the power supplied by the source will be 16 watt. We calculate the power supplied by the source of loop 2, which will be equal to E2 I2. The voltage across this source is 8. The current in this source is 2. So this source will supply a power of 16 watt. And the total power supplied by these two sources will be equal to 16 plus 16, which is 32 watt. We will do 3 more numerical examples later on. Thank you so much.